Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How is everyone tonight? This rather warm evening. Thanks for coming out to join us tonight. My name is Mark Razzi from the Public Services Office, and I'm glad you all came out to join us in our nice air-conditioned building tonight. Several international space agencies are actively engaged in robotic as well as human exploration of the moon, including projects from China, Japan, India, Russia, Germany, and the United Kingdom. NASA has also embarked on an active science and exploration program, which includes three robotic missions as well as human exploration starting in 2020. Tonight's presentation will discuss NASA's current plans for returning to the moon, as well as efforts to collaborate with international partners. Tonight's guest is the manager of the Lunar Robotic Exploration Program Office at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. He received his PhD from UCLA in 1989 in computer science and since then has worked at JPL. During his first 14 years at JPL, he worked in the technology development and technology management areas, including project manager of NASA's Micro Inspector Satellite Technology Project and center lead for the Center for Integrated Space Microsystems, to name a few. For the last 5 years at JPL, our speaker has led all of JPL's lunar robotic mission formulation efforts for both lunar science and lunar exploration missions. Most recently, in December 2007, NASA's Discovery program selected the Lunar Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory Science Mission Proposal for implementation, which he led. He is now leading JPL's proposal for a robotic lunar sample return mission. He is also an adjunct associate professor in the UCLA Computer Science Department, a member of the UCLA Computer Science Undergraduate Program External Advisory Board, an External Advisory Board member for the National Space Biomedical Research Institute, and a full member of the International Academy of Astronautics. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming tonight's guest, Dr. Leon Alkalai.
Good to have my family in the front row. Mark, thank you very much for the introduction. It's a real pleasure for me to be a speaker tonight. There are basically two talks tonight here at JPL and tomorrow at the Pasadena City College, and both are the same. And when I was asked to give this lecture, which seems like almost a year ago, I was really excited to be able to talk about the future plans for lunar science and exploration, and particularly honored to do so on this occasion. On Monday is the 40 years since the landing on the moon by Apollo 11, and today is actually 40 years from the launch of the Apollo 11. So it's a real special moment and special time in history. So it's a real pleasure for me to honor this occasion and be here with you. So whereas I will talk about the future of space exploration, I would like to pay as much as possible tribute and honor the brave and the courageous astronauts, engineers, and people who worked on the Apollo and other programs. So I'll briefly give an overview of the history of robotic and space exploration leading to the Apollo landing, and then I'll progress into the future. So let's start with some fun stuff.
15 seconds, guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engines running. We have a liftoff. We have an Apollo 11. 7.
4 forward, drift into the right wheel. 30 seconds forward, drift.
Contact right. Okay, engine stop.
Tranquility Base is the Eagle has landed.
Roger, tranquility,
we copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn through
the window. Armstrong is on the moon.
Yeah,
near
the
Apollo 11. 38 below the meridian, standing on the surface of the moon. On this July 20th, 1900,
on the runway.
11 mission, and before the human exploration portion of the mission, there was the robotic series of mission, and it really started off with the launch of the Soviet Sputnik 1 that was launched on October 4th, 1957. This, in fact, was the first artificial satellite launched into space by the Soviets, and it did take everybody, including the United States, by surprise. It was a big shock to have the Soviets outdo the Western democracies, and this was in the Cold War era, and so it was a real blow, a real stun. But soon after, the Explorer 1 was launched on January 1st, 1958, by the U.S.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, fire command, fire command. From the photographer, and exhausted as they were, the trio obliged with what was to be the page one spread in newspapers all over the world. In plain language, the United States was in the space business along with the Russians, and Explorer 1 was the beginning.
Shown also here on the same slide are William Pickering, James Van Allen, and Werner von Braun. If you have a moment after the lecture, you can actually go next door to the JPL Museum. At least there used to be a full-scale model of the Explorer 1. As opposed to the Sputnik 1, it was equipped with a scientific instrument, a Geiger counter, which actually was the first to detect what is now called and well known as the Van Allen belt, radiation belt. And this was first discovered by Explorer 1. But what ensued was basically a competition between the United States and the Soviet Union. And this was a race in space that was very much politicized. Every step was watched, every step counted. And in fact, at the beginning of this race, the Soviets clearly had the upper edge. They were first to launch the Sputnik 1 and 2 and with a series of firsts, including a first lunar impactor, an impacting spacecraft to the moon, a first to take pictures of the lunar far side, a first astronaut in space, and so on and so on. The United States had a series of programs, and I'll go through these programs one by one, very briefly giving you overviews, including the Ranger program, the Surveyor program, Lunar Orbiter, all as precursors to the Apollo program. And at the beginning, there were a lot of failures, a lot of mistakes, and then a series of successes, which I'll go through. Eventually, the Soviets actually did not succeed. If you look down here on this chart, to successfully complete these launch vehicles, which are called N1, there were four failures, which sort of were the equivalent to the U.S. Saturn V, which were the launch vehicles used to launch the Apollo missions to the moon. So the Soviets never succeeded in landing an astronaut on the moon, but they did continue with a pretty successful and vigorous robotic program. So the Ranger, as a precursor program, was very important. Its time frame was from 1961 to 65, and its objective was to impact the moon and return high-quality images. So let's watch this movie.
On July 31, 1964, NASA's Ranger 7 spacecraft impacted the moon in a pre-selected target area. The camera A pictures are now projected at 60 times the speed they were photographed. 1,120 kilometers to the moon.
576 kilometers to the moon. Impact. These first photographs from the four P cameras were taken 13 minutes, 40 seconds before impact. The total P series is projected at 28 times the speed at which they were taken. The four-channel P cameras recorded some 3,900 pictures. The cameras were aimed in such a way as to provide overlapping coverage with themselves and with cameras A and B.
Impact.
The other program that followed, Ranger, which is very, very important and actually is one of my favorite programs, is the Surveyor program. To this day, at JPL, we analyze and study carefully the results and the technology that was used in the 60s to do a soft landing on the moon with a series of Surveyor programs. It was developed as a precursor to the Apollo landings to both demonstrate the technology for what we call power descent or a soft landing, and also the approach that was used to land these the Surveyor landers was an approach that we still use today or still consider today, and that is they use a solid rocket motor to break the slow down the vehicle approaching the moon, then jettison that solid rocket engine and use hydrazine propulsion system to do a soft powered landing on the moon. To this date, we analyze these results and learn from the Surveyor missions from the 60s. There were seven missions, five of them were successful, and there were many, many first of a kind that were produced by the Surveyor missions, including a first hop on the moon. That means after the landers landed successfully and accomplished their mission, one was used to actually restart the engine and hop to a different location. Also, some of them were able to survive a lunar night, which is very, very cold. And even today, we struggle with approaches to make the robotic system survive a lunar night, which is extremely cold. So the Surveyor program was not only exciting scientifically, but an important technological demonstration before the Apollo mission. And then there was a series of lunar orbiter missions. Again, these were reconnaissance missions around the moon to find in very, very detailed, deliver detailed images of the moon and scout for locations for the future Apollo landings. And even today, as you'll hear a little bit later, we use the same approach that for future human landed missions, we need to have very detailed images of where we want to land. And then the Apollo program, which basically responded to Kennedy's commitment of May 1961 to land people on the moon and return them safely by the end of the decade. Just to conclude this chart, There were six two-person crews visited the lunar surface, and the results and activities continue to occupy generations of scientists. And finally, the Russians actually quit trying to get the their astronauts to the moon. And what I did for the next few charts, I'd like to just kind of, in a tribute to the astronauts and the Apollo program, just I picked a few of my favorite pictures from the Apollo program. There's plenty of them, but I hope you enjoy the next few. And this is one of my favorites. It's kind of symbolic. It's a rare picture of astronaut Charles Conrad Jr., the commander of the Apollo 12, who is actually seen here next to the Surveyor 3, a robotic lander, one of the landers that successfully landed on the moon as a precursor to the Apollo landing. And in the distance, you see the lunar lander module on the horizon. So it's, in a way, a sort of a closure between robotic and human programs. And in fact, what the astronaut did was to return the camera and the robotic scoop that you see here in front of him, and they're currently located at the Smithsonian Museum in Washington, D.C. So this is, in a way, a history lesson of what has happened, not only as part of the Apollo program, but in the robotic precursors to the Apollo program. And I found that even sometimes at JPL, or certainly in the professional community, not everybody remembers these programs, the Rangers and the Pioneers and Explorers and other programs that preceded the Apollo program. And to me, it's important to remember history and to learn from it as we go into the future of exploration. So now let me go and discuss a little bit the future of lunar exploration, and there is a lot to talk about. But the question does come up, why is the world going back to the moon, or why is the U.S. going back to the moon if we've been there 40 years ago with astronauts? Why are we going there today? Certainly it's an expensive venture. And the categories that I will describe here are typically broken down into exploration, science, and expression of national pride and technical progress. So in terms of exploration, clearly the moon represents the next frontier and potentially a frontier for a permanent human extraterrestrial outpost. And I'll show you some of the ideas and motivations to explore the moon. It is seen as a stepping stone for potential future human exploration of Mars. It's only fair to say that not everybody agrees with that, that if one is motivated to go on a human exploration of Mars, that you don't necessarily have to go via the moon, but certainly there is value in doing that. And there's a large community that is interested in resource utilization at the moon and in commercialization of space. But the science motivation to go to the moon is very strong, and I'll go through that separately. We know now about the moon more, much more than we did at the time of the Apollo program. And now we find evidence, compelling evidence, to go back to the moon just from purely scientific reasons, not even exploration in itself. But there's plenty of motivation to go to the moon, to explore the moon and the Earth-Moon system, and I'll go through that in more detail. The third topic here is expression of national pride and technical progress. That is certainly something that is engaging the Europeans, the Japanese, Chinese, India, the United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, Canada, not so much Russia, as they've been there like the United States. But the other countries do find it as part of their technical progress and as part of their national pride to go to the moon in various ways. What I'll show you next is a series of charts, a series of animations, videos, of what is referred to currently as the vision of space exploration. And this vision was announced during the George W. Bush presidency in December of 2004. And to this date, this remains the current program plan, and I'll go through that in detail. But it's only fair to say that as we speak, as of today, there is a renewal or a relook at this vision of space exploration by the Obama administration. And it is led by a very well-known figure and leader in the field, ex-executive of Lockheed Martin, Norm Augustine. And with other leaders in the field, they are compiling a recommendation to NASA and to the Obama administration as to suggestions for a renewed or a different kind of a plan for the exploration of the moon. So with this, the current program includes several elements. You'll see and hear about the Constellation program. And you'll see this Constellation program actually resembles in a large degree the Apollo program. The particular detailed elements are different, but the architecture and the framework of the program is very similar to the Apollo program. In addition to that, I'll discuss the precursor missions. Just like we had precursors to the Apollo program, just last month, on June 18th, NASA launched the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter and something called LCROSS, which I'll show you some charts on. There's a human research program looking at countermeasures for long-term human exposure to radiation, zero gravity, and so on. And there's a series of technology programs of which I'll show you some robotic systems that JPL is developing. There's also a commercial crew cargo program, which is a program to replace the shuttle access to the space station through a commercial vehicles. So with that, let me briefly discuss the Constellation program. So this is the current program, and you'll again see that it's very similar to the Apollo program. In this program, there's two launch vehicles that are being developed. One is called Ares 1 and Ares 5. And in the movie that you'll see the launches of both of these launch vehicles. The first one is called Crew Launch Vehicle. So this is where the crew would reside on something called a Crew Exploration Vehicle, and or the Orion vehicle, and that will be launched, and you see it over here in this picture here. The cargo vehicle will launch what is called the Earth Departure Stage and the Altair lander. The system will dock in lower Earth orbit, and the system propelled by the Earth Departure Stage will make its way to the moon. That stage will be jettisoned, and then the Orion crew exploration vehicle and the lander will go to the moon. At the moon, the crew exploration vehicle will go into orbit around the moon, and the lander will go to the moon on the surface. The lander, the Altair lander, has the ascent vehicle. So the astronauts, after coming out of the lander and doing their work on the surface of the moon, will go back into the ascent vehicle. The ascent vehicle will go into orbit, dock with the crew exploration vehicle. This service module will take it back to Earth, and the astronauts will come back to Earth. A nice way to show this, and this is very typical of how we show these kind of architectures, is something called a bat chart, like the animal bat hanging upside down. So you can see here Earth, you see here the moon, and we like to show basically this architecture. Here are the two launch vehicles. Here's the cargo vehicle going up, the crew vehicle going up. They dock in lower Earth orbit, they go to the moon, the lander goes to the surface, the crew exploration vehicle goes into orbit, the ascent module after the astronauts are done goes back up to the lunar orbit, docks with the crew exploration vehicle, comes back to Earth, and so on. So this is what we call the bat chart. So with that, let's enjoy the movie.
Back start.
Copy, during back start.
Fly back.
Yeah, three good. Copy,
three good.
Go.
Maximum pushback.
Go.
Cash will be up in the wrong.
That's permitted.
Copy.
So this is an artist's view of the Altair lander, slightly different than what you saw in the movie, but this is a more realistic view of the Altair lander, one of the possible designs. So you see the scale of these landers; they're pretty huge, humongous, and you see on top of the lander the ascent vehicle, which is again used for the astronauts to get into the ascent vehicle. Launch from the lander, dock with the crew exploration vehicle, and go back. One of the important things to study, and that's why we have these precursor missions that I'll talk about in a minute, is to decide where to land, where to build this permanent outpost if we decide to build such an outpost. And there's a lot of studies going on, and I'd like to just show one chart from a colleague of mine, Ben Bussey, from the Applied Physics Lab. This is a very important chart, and it kind of has a lot of interesting information. One of the locations that is being looked at as a possible destination, and there are many, is on the South Pole. And what happens on the South Pole, there's regions in the South Pole. If you look at this chart here, this shows percent of illumination during the year, and you see it goes from dark to white. And if you look at this is a Shackleton crater on the South Pole. This is the same crater enlarged, and you see that at the rim of Shackleton crater, there's this region white. This is not ice. This is just white, meaning that these are what are called peaks of eternal light. These are regions, because it's on the pole and because it's high in altitude, that there are regions here that basically are exposed to sunlight almost all year round. Not quite all year, but pretty much all year round. That's exciting and interesting because if you have an outpost there, and if you have solar arrays, you can potentially reap energy from the sun through solar arrays all year round, which is very, very important. There's another thing here. If you look at these dark areas, because you're at the pole, and because you're again of the geometry between the Earth, the Moon, and the Sun, there are regions inside the crater, especially if it's a deep crater, that are totally dark most of the year. In fact, there are regions of these craters, and this is not the only one, there are many, that have been dark for billions of years, that they've been totally always and never get exposed to sunlight. And as you'll see in a few charts, I'll show you, there's some evidence, possibility, that in these what we call cold traps, in these areas inside the crater where it's never been exposed to sunlight, there is a possibility that there is water or water ice. So if you have a source of energy on top of this peak, and if you have ways of mining or excavating and processing the water ice, if it were to exist in the cold traps, then you have basically the essential material for an outpost. You have energy and you have a source of water, which gives you hydrogen and oxygen and so on. So this is just an inset, a map of downtown DC that shows you the scale of what this is. This is about 26 miles across of this crater. So NASA and the NASA centers are eagerly studying different locations that are possibilities for a human outpost. This is an artist rendering of what a possible outpost may contain. And you see here a number of things, a habitation zone, and I'll show you a little bit more charts of that. A power generation zone. This is where you would set up your solar arrays and have your clean energy to the habitation. You have an excavation zone, observation zones, and landing zones, and so on and so on. This artist took a little bit liberty with placing the outpost a little bit too close for comfort to the to the cold trap, but that's being an artist. And certainly it's one view of a future outpost. In terms of building an outpost, you'll need a lot of elements, and NASA is clearly looking at a number of components, including the energy generation, including robotic vehicles, both unpressurized and pressurized rovers. So this is what we call unpressurized and a pressurized, where the astronauts can actually go in and not wear a suit. And this is the habitation area and so on. So this is, again, a possible layout of a future outpost. Another exciting capability that we have, and this is something that is particular to JPL, this is the actual area that I was just showing. This is the Shackleton Crater and the peak of Eternal Light. And this is a very high-resolution map of the South Pole. There are a few things to notice here. One is the color coding is artificial, so this is not real color. But the distance here in altitude and depression here is from 6 kilometers down to 6 kilometers up. So you see these very high peaks here, so the difference being 12 kilometers. The exciting thing about this particular map is that this map was not taken by a remote satellite around the moon, which I'll show you shortly from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. This map was actually taken from Earth. And this is taken from Goldstone radars here in California, where these antennas are basically shining or emitting an X-band beam that goes from Earth, from these antennas, goes to the moon, bounces back. We receive the signals at several different locations, and through a technique called interferometry, we generate these high-resolution maps. So these are actually high-resolution maps, and they're much more detailed than this, that are obtained from Earth of the moon. Really, really fantastic. So I'm now switching topics within this presentation from exploration, and I told you that science was a big part of a reason to go back to the moon. The way NASA likes to operate and is to, when it comes to science and science agendas, is to really ask the National Academy to prioritize and set an agenda for the agency and for the nation. There are two documents that are authoritative today in terms of lunar exploration. Something we call the Decadal Survey. This is done about once a decade, where it's called New Frontiers in Solar System Exploration, including the Moon. And this was produced in 2003. And then in 2007, it's important, the date, this was a few years after the Bush vision of space exploration, there was another committee that produced this document substantiating in a very significant way the reasons to go back to the Moon from a purely scientific point of view. And I'd like to read this statement, because this came from the National Research Council in 2007, which says, it is the unanimous consensus of the National Research Council Committee that the Moon offers profound scientific value, a vigorous near-term robotic exploration program providing global access essential to the next phase of scientific exploration of the Moon, and is necessary both to prepare for the efficient utilization of human presence and to maintain scientific momentum as this major national program moves forward. And I have two charts to just give you a feeling for why, what is so important about going back to the Moon from a purely scientific reason. Even if we did not go there from an exploration point of view, why should we go there from a purely scientific point of view? And this is detailed quite a bit in this scientific context for the exploration of the Moon. And the fact is that the Moon, and this we've actually explored and found out in the years after the Apollo program, the Moon is a witness to 4.5 billion years of solar system history, including meteorite and asteroid impacts and solar wind. The Moon is a historical cornerstone to our understanding of the planets and represents a record of planetary geologic processes in the purest form, unaltered by erosion, plate tectonics, and life. And the bottom line is that the Moon has preserved evidence of what has occurred over the last 4.5 billion years, whereas all the impacts, the craters, the asteroid, the impact, and so on, have all evaporated or have been erased from Earth due to weathering conditions and atmosphere and oceans and so on. They remain in their pristine form on the Moon. In a way, the way I like to think about it is that the Moon has become, in a way, a ancient archive of events that have transpired in the Earth-Moon system over the last several billion years. And going back to the Moon, whether it's with scientific robotic missions or human missions, we are going there to read exactly what happened over these several billions of years and understand what happened at the time when life originated on Earth. So there's a lot to learn about the Moon, about the Earth-Moon system, which is extremely important. So the question is often asked, is there any science left to do on the Moon after the Apollo? And I've clearly mentioned that that's been a pretty much a consensus, that the Moon has a lot of scientific information to give us. There are a few features that have particularly caught the scientists' attention, something that was not really known at the time of the Apollo program or soon after. And that is there's a sort of an anomaly or a phenomenon. There's something called the South Pole Aitken Basin. Between the South Pole and Aitken Crater, this whole area here, which is a huge, as if somebody with a ice cream scoop kind of carved out a chunk of the Moon, there's a huge hole here going down about 8 kilometers, a huge basin that has been created by an impact. And since then, there's been craters upon craters and impacts on top of that. But going to the South Pole Aitken Basin and sampling and age dating that region is extremely important for the science community, and which has been documented in both of the reports that I mentioned. Also, when you look at the map of the Moon in the radiogenic area abundance of thorium, again you see anomalies, and we don't understand exactly why. And then when we look at a spectrum of neutrons or hydrogen concentrations on the poles, We don't fully understand why there's high concentrations of hydrogen on the poles. There's groups who believe that that's the evidence of water or water ice. Others who don't believe that, who believe that this is pure hydrogen from the solar wind. So just as I mentioned from the Apollo program, the precursor missions, NASA does have several precursor missions going on right now. I mentioned LRO and LCROSS. They were just launched last month, and I'll tell you about that. India has the mission Chandrayaan 1, currently in lunar orbit. And the reason this is on a NASA chart is because the Indian Space Agency actually solicited and has a U.S., actually a JPL-built multispectral mapper on the Indian spacecraft. So we have a U.S. Instrument and a technology demo from Applied Physics Lab on Chandrayaan 1. I'll tell you about LRO and LCROSS, and I'll tell you about GRAIL. This is the mission that Mark, when he read my statement, this is what I was in charge of winning. So LRO and LCROSS were launched just last month, and
main engine ignition, and liftoff of the Atlas V rocket with LRO LCROSS, America's first step in a lasting return to the moon.
So this was launched just last month. LRO is currently in orbit around the moon, actually producing very exciting data. I can actually stop this. This is so LRO is currently in lunar orbit, and LCROSS is an impactor, a lunar crater observation and sensing satellite. I'll show you more about that. And this mission is being implemented by NASA Ames, and they are launched together, LRO and LCROSS. And LRO is particularly exciting. It is a lunar orbiter that has six instruments and a technology demonstration. And these instruments were particularly chosen to provide detailed images of the moon. And when I say detailed, this LROC camera from a company called Malin Space Science Systems in San Diego, they're providing images, spot images of the lunar terrain at a resolution of 50 centimeters. So 50 centimeters resolution per pixel of the moon. LOLA is an instrument, the Lunar Orbital Laser Altimeter, which will give us very precise mapping, 3D mapping of the terrain. Diviner, LEND, and LAM. Diviner is a thermal mapper. It gives us the temperature of the surface. LEND is a neutron detector. LAMP is a Lyman alpha mapping. All these three instruments are designed to retire basically the question or answer the question as to whether there is water in these cold traps at the poles or not. And LCROSS is an exciting mission. This doesn't have any sound, I believe, so I'll talk over this. In fact, this, as I mentioned, is implemented by NASA Ames, our colleagues. In fact, this was selected in a competition where this mission and the mission that I proposed were in the finals, and this mission was selected, and very happy for my colleagues at NASA Ames. And they actually have JPL doing the navigation for this mission. The mission includes an impactor, basically the upper stage of the Atlas launch vehicle, which is going to impact the one of these craters in the cold trap and create a huge plume that then this other attached spacecraft is going to fly through that plume, sample it, and sense whether there is water ice. In addition to that, the impact will be so huge that it will be visible from Earth. And I've listed here the impact date, October 9th, 4:30 a.m. And there are constant postings on the NASA website as to the precise timing of the impact, and we will know that within a second what the exact impact. I also want to thank my colleague Dan Andrews, who's the project manager for LCROSS. He sent me this animation, which actually shows, or not animation, this is a real images from Sierra remote observatories, actually shows the LCROSS as imaged by an astronomer going across the skies, which I thought was really neat to see this real image. And this is the GRAIL mission, another purely science mission that was proposed. I was leading this competition for JPL, and the principal investigator for this mission is Maria Zuber from MIT. The project manager at JPL is David Lehman, and I was the formulation lead for this mission. In a very short term, what GRAIL does is based on an existing concept of a mission called GRACE that is operating at Earth. We put together a mission around the moon that measures the gravity of the moon very, very, very precisely. And what happens when you measure the gravity of a planet, Earth, or the moon, and you measure it very precisely, it basically tells you at that instant where you measure the gravity, it tells you what the gravitational pull is at that location. As you map the gravity field very precisely across the whole planet, it basically gives you the mass distribution inside the planet. It tells you where the crust and the mantle are differentiated. It tells you if it has a core. You can detect whether the core is moving or not moving, what it's composed of, and so on. So the key is to basically measure the gravity of the moon at a certain altitude very, very precisely. And we do that by using two spacecraft that are connected in a way through an RF signal. So they're not physically connected, but they're at a distance of about 200 kilometers. And they have a tone, basically an RF signal, going one way and the other way. And it's almost like they each have a rubber band holding onto each other. And as one spacecraft is tugged just a slightly by the higher or lower gravitational pull, at that instant, the other spacecraft, it's like holding a fishing rod, just detects that little pull on the other spacecraft. And they each detect it on each other's end, and we basically collect that information and very, very precisely determine the gravity, the precise gravity of the moon. And then from that, we can understand what is inside the moon. So we basically call this as a mission from crust to core, and this mission will launch in 2011. I mentioned the South Pole Aitken Basin as an exciting target for exploration, for science. I'm not going to dwell on this, but just to show you here in a little bit higher resolution, the South Pole Aitken Basin, and in this case, from Aitken to South Pole, this whole region, which is almost like a quarter of the moon, is a region of great interest to scientists. And so now for my last portion of this talk, to go into a little bit more technological, I think quite exciting things that are going on at JPL. And I'll go through this rather fast. In fact, this is something called Athlete, which is a six-legged robotic system, which is being considered as part of the Constellation technology program for future outpost systems, for both deploying, for moving large objects around, and so on. The nice thing about this six-legged, both legged and wheeled robotic system is that it can navigate very, very complex terrains. One can spend a whole day lecturing about this in the sense of all the capabilities that this robotic system has. We've actually demonstrated here at JPL, and I should mention the project manager for this project is Brian Wilcox. He has this test setup where we, in this case, have a simulated 1/6G landing system and airbags to look at what's the right way to deploy the Athlete robotic system on the moon. And this is actually a quarter scale system. This is a huge robotic system, but for it to be the size of the Altair lander that I showed you earlier, this would be four times the size. This is an exciting, what I call the ballet of two rovers, where they're given a task to together jointly perform an activity of moving objects around. And you can see this as part of a robotic system, a colony of robots that can be used to actually assemble an outpost, perhaps ahead of the astronauts, and perform a lot of capabilities. In fact, each one of these legs could be scavenged by another of the athletes to, in case of a failure. And these wheels can be replaced with all kinds of tools, much like a Swiss Army knife. I'm excited to also show you one of the latest things that JPL is doing. I mentioned that it's important to have a way to explore the what we call the lunar cold traps. These are these very, very deep areas that have never seen light for billions of years. And it's a challenge. How do you reach these areas? They're very, very hard to reach. So what we've been working on, and in particular ESA Nesnes here at JPL, has been working on something called AXL. And AXL is a robotic system that is tethered. The model that we envision is that a lander would land, much like that artist rendering, close to a crater, perhaps not as close as the artist had intended, and then actually on wheels move closer to the rim, and then deploy the AXL rover or robot that can basically navigate these very, very steep terrains where no rover can basically sustain. It would basically slip and roll over. A rover couldn't really navigate these terrains. So an AXL kind of a system with a tethered anchor to the lander above could actually do that. In this case, that we've demonstrated here at JPL, the ability to actually go down a deep, basically extreme terrain, sample, and bring that sample back to the lander. And in this case, you'll see the robot traversing very, very extreme terrain, which in many ways would be hard for a robotic a rover to do. And here you see the AXL going back up, using the tether to go back to the mothership, to the lander. So now the last few minutes, what I'd like to simply say is that there's a lot going on at the moon, not only in the US, but I mentioned India, Japan, China, the Europeans, and these are some of the images of only the recent missions. This is from the Chandrayaan-1 orbiter around the moon. This is from the Japanese Kaguya mission that is currently around the moon. The Chinese had the Chang'e mission, which is no longer around the moon, but recently in 2007 launched. And the Europeans had the Smart One in 2005, which also launched. The Indians have a plan together with the Russians to launch a follow-on mission called Chandrayaan-2, which is actually intended to be a lander and a rover. And I believe this is currently planned for 2012 or 2013, and they're planning to do this with the Russians. The British have plans. They have a mission in a concept called Moonlight, and the Russians are planning a mission called Lunar Globe. With that, what I'd like to do is just summarize my presentation. And what I try to present here is a historic perspective on both the Apollo program and the precursor robotic programs, the reasons for exploration and for science. And I would like to recognize the people who have helped me make this presentation, some of them here in the audience, and I'm really grateful to their help. And my last chart is shown here. I really like this kind of a symbolic a collage of images showing the Earth, the space station, and the moon. And as I mentioned, there's the Augustine Commission that is currently putting together a new roadmap for NASA and for space exploration. And we'll find out what exactly that entails in the next month or two. But in my opinion, especially as we stand here today and honoring the 40 years since the Apollo program, and that it's important that we continue to explore and pursue scientific knowledge. It's important that we inspire, educate, and lead the way into the future. So with that, I thank you for your attention. My understanding is that there is some time for questions, that you should come up to the microphone if you have a question. There's a microphone here.
I have a three-part question.
Okay.
One, because it's not cost productive to use materials to go to the moon, is it possible that we can find materials on the moon for construction? And secondly of all, regard to the ignatius materials that are found in the regolith, is there anything aside from olivine and pyroxene that can be utilized in building? And thirdly of all, are there spectroscopes and cryogenic detectors on the LRO?
Well, let me take the first question about materials. Yes, there's a huge community, primarily at the JSC in Houston, that is working on a program called In-Situ Resource Utilization, ISRU. I'm sure if you Google that, you'll find plenty of information. But they are looking, and they actually have test beds in the labs of demonstrating how you can utilize indigenous material from the moon to do a number of different things, to basically get oxygen from ferroxides on the moon, from to basically, depending on whether there's water or just hydrogen, to use that to produce methane and propellant. So it is not so much a matter of that we can't take materials. If we can generate resources on the moon, it certainly would remove the need to bring them from Earth. So there's a huge community and a large interest and a lot of work in looking at in-situ resource utilization at the moon. So the answer is yes. The second part of the question is there's also a lot of work going on what to actually do and how to perform certain tasks on the moon, let's say as part of an outpost, in terms of building infrastructure with materials that are right there at the moon, including using microwave technology to basically melt and create roads on the moon from the regolith. There's plenty of ideas of how to use, in fact, how it's important to use the regolith as a shield against radiation, to basically build tunnels or use existing features to build shelters from solar flares, which are deadly if they were to occur. And what was the third one?
The third part of the question was, are there any spectroscopes or cryogenic detectors on the LRO?
Not on LRO. The closest would be the Diviner, which is a thermal mapper, which will be able to do a very detailed thermal map of the moon. But there are future in-situ instruments that are being looked at for future landers and so on.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, so first off, I'll make it a little easy for you. When L-Cross hits the moon, what is the plume going to look like from Earth? Is it going to look like a gigantic puffball in the sky, or is it going to be a dot on the moon? And is it going to be seen in like the like nighttime sky, or is it going to be seen on the moon?
Very good question.
We've
actually analyzed very carefully what the plume may look like. There's been a lot of people analyze what is called the whole process of impact cratering, not just L-Cross, but what happens when a meteor hits the moon, what kind of crater it produces. So there's a lot of simulations, and I could have shown some, that it basically will look like you would expect, a sort of an excavated kind of a plume, and it will go very, very far out into space. It's basically a ballistic process where the dust is blown out into space, and it will go hundreds of kilometers into space. And depending on the angle from the sun, as the sun illuminates that plume, it will be a very, very spectacular view. It will may not be seen with a naked eye, but with a simple telescope, it will be seen.
Okay. Next off, I've been thinking about this question before, even before this lecture series. How come on Jupiter and Saturn and all the other little planets out there, we have Titan, Io, but why isn't our moon named? Why is it just simply called Moon? Why can't we have a name? Are we too special?
What would you call it?
Why isn't our moon named? I mean, it's just Moon. Originality 0%.
I have no idea.
So far, no one does. Thank you, though.
You should name it. Yourself, you should name it.
Yes! I'm going to try that. Name the moon.
I kind of have an idea and a question.
Okay.
Which one should I start with?
Idea.
Okay. My idea is if you could send a little module thingy down onto the peak of eternal light, that, and send a little rover into the crater, but if the rover runs out of energy, up at the top module, it has solar energy and it'll charge up there. Mm-hmm. And would it be possible to send energy through like waves?
Yes. Oh my God.
Then you could send energy to it in the crater and it could go on farther.
This is a very, very good question. Is this an idea or a question?
Well, it's an idea, but I'm wondering if it's possible.
It is possible. It is possible. Okay. And I think you should continue coming up with these great ideas.
Thank you. And my question is, what time do you think we'll, that the any part of the world will colonize on the moon?
Well, the current plan, and as I mentioned, it's being revisited, but the current plan does start for the first human landing on the moon to be in 2020. So you'll be plenty young for that landing. And so that's currently the plan. The question is right now whether that plan will stay or not, and a lot depends on the current administration and so on. But it can be done as early as 2020, which is not really that too far away.
And so that's just going to be just a little itsy bitsy small, like three people, right?
3D or what?
Is it going to be like just like three people in a little thing?
Oh,
or is it going to be like a
The landers are designed for four people at a time. It used to be for six up till recently, and they realized that that's more expensive. So now it's nice when you can scale back people. So now the system is designed for four people at a time.
Okay.
Thank you. Very good questions.
Although there's a lot of space on and around the moon, is there ever any conflict between the various countries and the missions that they are doing? And how do they resolve conflicts or decide who's going to do what?
Very, very good question. Again, there's no, at the moment, conflict, and there's also no ownership of real estate on the moon, according to international space treaties. So the answer is no. There's no kind of two countries vying for the same plot of land and things like that. But what I can say is that I think the world and the U.S. could do a better job of collaborating to go to the moon. And I certainly would like to see more of that. Sometimes the public and the media perhaps views the current roadmaps or the current missions by China, Japan, and India and others as somewhat of a competition. But for the U.S., it shouldn't be. We've been there 40 years ago, and we've done so much. And so my view is much more that we should help the world and the others to reach the moon, and that would be much more of a goodwill gesture, and there should be more of it. So that's my point of view.
Hi, so many questions, but I'll ask a JPL-specific one since that's where we are. How do they decide which unmanned spacecraft, since that's JPL's mission, which ones do they build here, and how do they decide which ones to farm out to the other guys?
Very good question. I mentioned a few times the competitions, where, for example, GRAIL is a competition that we won. NASA has programs, Discovery, New Frontiers, SMECS, Scouts, different programs within Lunar or Mars programs and so on, and they have competitions. In these competitions, JPL can win or lose. And the competitions are decided by very rigorous peer reviews. And so that's one way that JPL gets a mission, by winning a competition. Now, maybe the follow-on question, well, who is our competition? And so there is a competition amongst other NASA centers, amongst other national labs, applied physics labs, and other places, and we compete. And those are missions that I mentioned and acknowledged my colleagues at NASA Ames. They won LCROSS. I had a lunar impactor finalist mission that didn't win. And that's one answer. And the other answer is that some missions are specifically assigned to NASA centers. You may hear certain Mars missions that are being implemented by JPL. And those missions are purely assigned. And this is a NASA call. NASA makes that call whether to assign a mission to JPL or to Ames or to JSC and so on. And they balance out the kind of workforce issues versus fairness versus who's best to do the mission. Many of the Mars missions are done at JPL because we've done most of them. And even if we were to compete, most probably nobody would win. So there's kind of a balance between assigned missions and competed missions.
Yay, Donna Shirley and Steve Squires.
I'm sorry?
Yay for Donna Shirley and Steve Squires. And I think Tony Spears was on the same mission as Donna Shirley.
Yes, yes. Well, thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
So I'm listening to you, and it seems like you have a lot of deep involvement in space exploration. I was just wondering if you believed in aliens or extraterrestrial force, or you've seen any kind of living organisms that the public may not know about.
And if I did, I would reveal it right here. Right?
Yes, please do.
Well, I'll answer the first one seriously, and the second one I think I already answered. I do believe that there is that we will find evidence of life outside of Earth. Maybe not.
You haven't seen it yet?
I haven't seen it. The closest we've got is the Phoenix mission recently on Mars has detected water, but not evidence of life. If there were, it would have been you would not have missed it.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, I got a three-part question. I guess the first part, it's all quick. The first part is, what kind of propulsion system did the Apollo missions use to exit or to leave the surface of the moon? And what are we using now? And the third part is, how high up do you have to be in space in order to start orbiting the moon when you leave the surface?
Let me answer the second part. Did you say three or two?
Yeah, well, what kind of propulsion system did we use back then and now when we're going to leave the moon's surface?
Well, it's a very interesting question because there are many parts to this answer, and it turns out a lot of the technologies that were built in the 60s, including propulsion technologies, do not really exist today. And I mentioned earlier that Surveyor program is one of my favorites. One of the concepts that we've been working on is something called network of landers, We're looking at what does it take to send many landers to the moon, small landers, maybe the size of this podium here, and send a bunch of them. And when we started looking at that, we said, well, let's look at what Surveyor did. You saw the size of Surveyor, perfect kind of a lander for a network mission. And we looked at, can we get today the technology that was used in the 60s, which is basically a throttable engine. What that means is that as you're going down and landing on the moon, your basically mass is changing because you're consuming fuel. So if you had a constant thrust while landing, you'd basically go like this, right? So you have to vary your thrust as you go down very, very carefully because you're consuming, your mass is going down as you're going down, so you have to kind of throttle back as you go down, very complex. And when we looked at this, I said, I want to do a mission today like Surveyor. We couldn't do it. The technology, meaning off the shelf, it's not like we don't know how to do it. We have all the blueprints. But if we wanted to go to a vendor and say, build us one of these, it doesn't exist. It can be built. And the reason it doesn't exist is that basically NASA did not have programs that would sustain a product like this in industry. So yes, we could have kept it in-house, but you kind of keep what you need for the next missions and so on. So the propulsion technology is across the board. There's more advanced technologies today, bipropellant hydrazine engines, which have much higher thrust, but therefore much larger systems and so on. So on the second part of your question, which I think is very interesting, what altitude do you need to be at to be in lunar orbit? And we have looked at that a number of different ways. The GRAIL mission can go down to, let's say, 50 kilometers of altitude. And we've looked at even 35 kilometers of altitude. The difficulty at that point is that at that level, any slight variations in your knowledge of the height could be deadly. I mean, you could hit one of these peaks of eternal light or whatever it is. And because of the current lack of knowledge in the gravity, you basically could be falling up and down quite a bit just due to the gravity uncertainty. So anything below 30 kilometers altitude around the moon is kind of out of the question. Above that is okay, 50 is fine, 100 is easy.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Hi, I was just wondering, does NASA and other space programs, did they ever find opposition from people who just believe that the moon should be left alone? Is there opposition, like politically or something, to colonization of the moon? Do people say, just let the other planets be?
I think I haven't encountered strong opposition. I think there is clearly strong opinions in terms of how we approach the moon, and there are current guidelines and current rules that NASA has in terms of, as the international presence at the moon increases, how we deal with certain things like disposal of these rockets, disposals of the various systems. And there are all kinds of regulations we have to go through to ensure certain content of materials and so on. And I think that kind of a pressure and demand, not only from the public, from the engineers working on these systems, is just going to be stronger and stronger. But in terms of just blank rule, don't ever send any more humans, just leave it to itself, I haven't heard that particularly.
Right, and then I had a second unrelated question. Would it be possible in the future to retrieve old lunar modules and stuff and recycle their parts?
Well, it's not clear why you would want to do that in terms of bringing them back to Earth. But if I can take that question in its spirit, if we have multiple landings on the moon in order to build an outpost, we are looking at very carefully, if you notice, that Alter lander lands on the moon and then the ascent vehicle goes back up. Well, if you have a bunch of these, then you're leaving these huge landers on the moon, nobody's using them. So there are serious efforts to look at, okay, if I leave that lander after I leave the moon, how do I make use of that structure to build an outpost, or to use it as a storage, or to use it for as a useful device? And what we've been looking into is, if these landers had wheels, just like the athlete robot, so it lands, the astronauts do their thing, and then they unfold their little wheels, and then they can go and dock with each other and create a platform. So we're very much looking at how we can reuse what perhaps would seem like waste, but how we would use it in a constructive way.
Thank you.
You're welcome. These are very tough questions.
Yeah. my questions regarding cosmic rays. Mm-hmm. I know during the last Apollo missions, like, they didn't really care too much about that, but they were pretty short term. How long is the next manned mission planned to? How long are they supposed to be on the moon for?
In the current Constellation program and the human outpost, the intent is for them to be in an outpost, in a human habitat, up to 6 months at a time, not more.
Yeah. Okay. So then my question is, what kind of systems have been designed or being designed to protect them from cosmic rays?
So there's two parts to that question, one that you didn't ask, which I'll answer, and the other one that you did ask, and that is, we have to have in place space weather monitoring ability. So basically, you monitor the sunspots and you monitor the solar flares in order, as an early warning system for the astronauts. Then one would expect that in the habitat modules, there would be one module, at least one module, that would be resilient to radiation, that would have particular radiation shielding embedded in the module, that while they're doing their regular work, they're about doing their business, but when the alarm goes on saying, you know, there's a solar flare coming your way and the solar radiation, within minutes, they have to, or hours, they would have to basically make it to the shelter where they would be safe from these storms. There are other ideas, as I mentioned, using the regolith, building structures where you can put the lunar regolith on top and use the regolith as a shield. The regolith, there's been many studies on that. The regolith is a very, very good shield against radiation.
Okay. Has there been research on long-term effects of just kind of the general
Yes, there has. There's a huge program at NASA on the radiation effects on biology and tissue. There's been experiments at the space station. So it's been a research topic for several decades.
I mean, obviously, if there's like a solar flare, they're going to jump in there. But I mean, like, in between, where you just have your
In between, the moon is actually very benign in terms of radiation. And so in terms of total ionizing dose, cosmic rays, in a regular day-to-day, it would be quite benign. Okay. And they would normally have monitors for ionizing dose monitoring.
Okay.
So it's really the flares that are killers.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
My first question is, what advantage is gained by having two separate rockets launch, one with the people and one with the food, as opposed to just launching, say, one with the astronauts and then sending another directly to the moon with a landing system similar to that of the Mars rovers?
Yeah, it's a matter of economics and matter of kind of modularity. The systems that you see now, the Ares 5 and Ares 1, are actually the most cost-effective way to do it. In any design of any complex system, there's something called top-down and bottoms-up. If you start from scratch, you can do a perfect design, but it will cost a lot.
Yeah.
But if you start from existing parts, it may not be the perfect design, but it's the most cost effective. So the current launch vehicles use components from the shuttle booster. They use, they reuse existing technology to give you a smaller launch vehicle for the crew, and the other launch vehicle, it's not for food, it's the cargo is for the lander and so on. So it's really, it's kind of the best engineering way to do it rather than the perfect way to do it.
And what kind of How does that work? I mean, how do they interface? Like, to what degree is that software controlled and pre-calculated, and to what degree is it actual navigation by the astronauts aboard?
Well, it's actually with today's technology, it would all be pre-programmed and more or less on autopilot.
Yeah.
With astronaut override, I'm sure. But it's the technology is there for very precise navigation today.
And then one more unrelated question. Is the reason that the gravity of the moon is so unknown due to the uneven distribution of the Maria lava flows?
Let me correct. We understand, we know the gravity of the moon very well.
Uh-huh.
1/6 g, it's perfectly known. It's not so much the unknown, it's the ability to measure, let's say, the fifth or sixth decimal of that gravity.
Okay.
So it's 1/6, whatever, point.
Yeah.
It's that 10th decimal. And then measuring that precision, I don't care if it's at the Earth or the Moon or any other planet. And then as that varies, and you understand that it varies only because of the gravity and nothing else, solar wind and everything, you can model that out, now you're measuring the effect of mass.
Mm-hmm.
And that tells you the mass distribution. On Earth, we have the GRACE mission, which does the same, and they measure and can detect the Amazon rain movement, when mass, rain falls in the Amazon, and they that mass of water comes from the clouds down to the ground. It changes gravity.
Wow. That's
That's detectable.
Sorry?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Hi. Hey. Hello. Great lecture.
Thank you.
I, when hearing about the name is leaving me, the way the harnessing energy from solar beams and also from water, I was wondering what had been looked into from if we were to colonize fuel cells and specifically the new developments in like solid acid and solid oxide fuel cells.
Well, there's for lunar systems like an outpost, fuel cells are very much in the mix of technologies that is being looked into. The most natural one is solar energy. It's in abundance, and the capability is available, and the technology is there. So, having large solar arrays is one. Fuel cells is definitely another one. And a third one that is very, very possible and doable is nuclear energy as well. So nuclear, fuel cells, and solar are all options on the table.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
One question.
Okay.
Something I've read about in the past or heard about in the past as one of the scientific reasons to go back to the moon, and I didn't hear you mention it.
Okay.
I don't know if it's in the current plans or not, would be to put radio telescopes on the far side of the moon where they wouldn't be affected by Earth's radio magnet, you know, the waves coming out, you know, our TV programs and whatnot. Is that part of the plan?
I actually didn't say it, but I did. It is there. the moon is an excellent platform for improved scientific observations of the universe. And then and before I did mention it. So you're absolutely right. And there are a number of different programs, research, studies on putting observatories, various kinds, low-frequency radio wave telescopes, and putting telescopes, optical telescopes and others, that are basically on the far side of the moon, shielded from the Earth and the radio interference from the Earth. So there's lots of good ideas. The only downside of anything like this is the fact that it's not easy to do. Mm-hmm. It's expensive. And putting a large mirror or a large radio telescope and so on, it has to be a particular kind of mission and incentive for NASA to do something like that. But there's no shortage of rationale and ideas and people who are looking into this right now. So if I didn't say it, it clearly is a very important reason.
The crater that you mentioned that's towards the South Pole, is the configuration of that crater, if we know it, could you put some of this sort of scientific instrumentation in that crater and have it shielded, or is it not
Well, if you notice on that artistic rendering of the Shackleton crater next to the precipice, mm-hmm. there was a little cartoon there of observatory. Mm-hmm. So that people are thinking about just that. The question is, if it's a radio telescope, then you want it to be on the far side, not in view of Earth, mm-hmm. because all the interference from Earth. If it's an optical telescope or some others, then it could be somewhere on the Shackleton crater or so. So it's definitely